Welcome to our historical tour of the structures of Ripon College. I'm Jack Crist, and I first came to Ripon in 1970 after growing up on the East Coast like many of Ripon's early citizens. During my 43 years of working at the college, I had offices and taught classes in several of the buildings that will be featured in this video. The very first campus structure was East Hall, staked out in a snowstorm in 1851. East Hall is where it all began, and as you'll see over the past 166 years, Ripon College staff and students have continued their journey through campus by walking on sunshine.
Ripon, of course, is distinct in that it has a nationally recognized quality liberal arts college in its midst, and that college has been here for a long time. It was, in fact, one of the very first acts of the founding of this town, thinking that it might be useful in terms of real estate values to have a college or Lyceum as they called it then, located in the town. The town fathers appropriated the money set aside for setting up a primary school and built a college instead.
Another reason those early settlers, led by David Mapes, wanted to build the college was to attract other settlers to the area with a deep respect for education and thus a concern for the long-term viability of the community. Or, as early Riponite Jediah Bowen put it, whatever motives there may have been, one great one inspired them all. The pioneers were bound to show their respect for education.
To really understand the background of our club and its founding members, we have to just take a minute to talk about the history of Ripon during the early 1800s. So the people who came to Ripon generally came from the East Coast. Some came from Europe. The government had sent out advertisements, particularly to Germany, urging people to come to settle the West, to settle the frontier. So we have investors coming from the East Coast. These were generally people, they were businessmen. They were educated people. And their families were educated. One thing that was very important to them was education. But they were also very religious people, and they were very family-oriented people. But they had a strong focus on education, which meant that this community, this little frontier community, came up with the money to establish a college in 1851. This was unusual for the times, and it was a sacrifice for the people, but again, the point of how important education was.
The largest bid pledged towards the founding of the college was $250, and it was made by local merchant William S. Brockway. On January 29, 1851, the date accepted as the official founding of Ripon College, the state of Wisconsin granted a charter to Brockway College. Mr. Brockway's pledge was never paid in full, so the college eventually adopted the name Ripon. It is still one of the few colleges in the United States to be named after the city in which it was founded. The changing of the college's name, however, was not the only thing different back then. Ripon College history professor Russell Blake, who came to Ripon in 1981, explains.
East Hall was the very first building. It was in fact called East College. Because buildings in the 19th century were not called halls, they were called colleges. The reason for that is that they were a multi-purpose building. The three original buildings at Ripon were East College, which was built right before the Civil War, and then West College and Middle College were built a little bit after the Civil War. East College had a chapel in it, or a room that was used as a chapel, and was also an administrative building. East College is famous for the fact that it was used by a local regiment at the time of the Civil War as their headquarters, and they in fact met and camped out on the hill between the college and the downtown before they went off to the Civil War.
The Civil War actually caused Ripon College to close down for 1 year. No classes were held in 1861 as the 1st Wisconsin Cavalry Regiment occupied the buildings, including Middle Hall, which was under construction at the time. It was completed in 1863, followed by the building of West Hall in 1867.
So you had these three buildings in a row at the top of the hill, and all built with the same kind of stone, and all pretty much designed the same kind of way. But Middle and West, in the very early days of the Ripon, before 1900, were residence halls and also some classroom buildings and some professors' offices. West Hall had the dining room in it, but this building, East Hall, never had any people living in it, as far as we know. And then the next building that was built was Bartlett, and that was built down at the bottom of the hill in the 1880s. And Bartlett was built specifically to be a woman's residence. At that time, the men all lived on the buildings on the top of the campus, and the women lived down in Bartlett. But for a long, long time, those were the only buildings at Ripon College. Ripon, like most schools in the Midwest, would buy up older homes that were around the college and big old-fashioned Victorian homes, and they would use those for dorms or offices or a little bit of everything. Right across the street, Ransom Street from East Hall, is a building that was a residence hall for a while and was actually the infirmary for a while. So these old buildings around campus sort of supplemented the other buildings for quite some time.
Bartlett Cottage, as it was known, was built in 1888. The largest single gift of $6,000 was made by Lucy Bartlett of Oshkosh, who asked that the building be named after her late husband, Sumner. Bartlett provided apartments for 44 women, and the September 30, 1887 edition of the Ripon Commonwealth described it as more pretentious than any of the earlier buildings. It was the first campus building to have steam heat rather than wood stoves, and later hardwood floors, electricity, and somewhat modern plumbing. Bartlett's interior comfort and exterior architecture allowed it to quickly become the showpiece of the entire campus. The building still stands today, but Doug Northrup, who came to Ripon in 1960, says that almost wasn't the case.
Bartlett Hall was the women's cottage for many years. Upper class women lived there. Younger women lived in tri-dorms, freshmen. They moved them out. There was a interesting series of discussions whether Bartlett would be torn down or not. The women who lived there protested mightily, wanted it as a historic building. So it was added on to the Union and linked together in one of the Union remodelings, Harwood Memorial Union.
Harwood was completed in 1942, but more than six decades before that, Ripon College undertook its first major remodeling job when East College was rebuilt and enlarged.
East College actually underwent extensive renovation only 20 years after it was built in 1874. The whole inside of it was reconfigured and torn apart. So the only thing that really remains from the original East College is the are the walls. East Hall was also renovated right before I came in 1980-81 and was extensively redone then.
Through all the various renovations of East Hall over the years, the building has maintained its significance on campus. In recognition of its place in the history of Ripon College, East Hall was eventually added to the National Register of Historic Sites in 1995. Another prominent and historic college building was built in 1900. Ingram Hall was named after a wealthy lumber baron from Eau Claire, Orrin H. Ingram. He was a member of the Ripon College Board of Trustees, who was recommended by Samuel Pedrick, a recent alumnus and Ripon resident. The two men met at an oratorical contest between Ripon and Beloit, and Ingram was to eventually become the most generous contributor to the college in his time. His $15,000 challenge grant was matched by an additional $25,000, which made possible the construction of the new science building named in Ingram's honor.
In 1900, Ingram Hall was built. Ingram Hall no longer stands. It was torn down 68-69. It was a big, ugly, old red brick building, which when I came here and started asking about Ingram Hall, all the professors who knew anything about it said it was a horrible building. And it was really only 70 years old when it was torn down. Most buildings last a lot longer than that, even at Ripon. They last a lot longer than that. But apparently it had shoddy construction from the beginning and never got good repair jobs, and so they decided just to tear it down.
Well, the most significant building that's gone is probably Ingram Hall, which was the main classroom building, and everything was there, basically all classes, including some physical education classes. All the science programs were there.
The early 1900s brought important changes to a couple of Ripon College's oldest buildings. In 1905, the West Hall dining facilities opened, and in 1903, Middle College was renamed Smith Hall in honor of donor Elisha D. Smith, who gave the majority of funds for the renovation of the building.
Middle Hall is now Smith. It was Smith once, then it was Middle, and now it's back to Smith. So some of us like to call it Middle Smith.
I moved into Middle Hall when I became dean of faculty and had an office there, different furniture from time to time, but the same office with the president across the way and secretary attached. Consultants came in. Stott was very annoyed at my office. It looked dingy, utilitarian, inappropriate. So he hired consultants to come in who prescribed furniture for me and reestablished it so that people could not just walk into my office. They had to go down the hall into the secretary's office and then back through, and they had to walk the length of my office to get to my desk, because the further you are from the entrance, the more prestigious your power. I thought it was hilarious, basically.
Both Northrop and Blake also have fond and funny memories of Memorial Gymnasium, which was built in 1910 and remained a focal point of campus until being torn down in the late 1990s.
The snake pit. It was a terrible place for visiting teams to come, because the crowd was jammed in right down to the sidelines, and the noise was enormous. They had those paper boxes up on the ceiling. Those of you who are old enough will remember. John Updike remembered. He had his honorary degree conferred on him there. When he came back a number of years later looking for his son to go to college, he said to the director of admissions, "Don't you have a gym with paper boxes on the ceiling?" And Chris Small said, "Yeah, we do. Why were you there?"
When I came in 1981, Memorial Gymnasium had, hadn't been a gym for a long time, not since 1968. It was used for concerts. A former professor, or a professor at that time of Ripon, Jim Hyde, who was a German professor and also a really accomplished violinist, and he was kind of an amateur acoustical engineer. He designed a sound system in there, or acoustic system really, that made this old barn-like building really good for concerts. So the Milwaukee Symphony played there every year, and other concerts took place there. It was really kind of an unusual situation. I think that it was used mainly for intramural events. I remember that we always had registration before campus there. My main memory of Memorial Hall, my first few years here, would be on hot August days going in for registration, and there being about 1,000 flies flying around the building, and faculty would bring fly swatters to the table as freshmen would come up to register. They go whomp, and flies would be killed in front of them. But the building had been shut up all summer, and it was just really fly-ridden.
And it was absolutely a snake pit. Every seat was always taken for a basketball game. Faculty, if they wanted to get promoted, had better show up at those games. So the president had his seat, and the dean had his seat, and the faculty gathered as close as you could around them and cheered. And the noise in there was enormous. And I remember particularly one game we were playing Lawrence, back when Lawrence and Ripon were relatively, well, I guess over the years they have been relatively, even in basketball. And it got down to the final moments of the game, and the score was tied, and something happened, and the Lawrence captain said, "Timeout!" And they didn't have any timeouts left. And it was a foul on them for calling a timeout. But the noise was so immense, you couldn't hear a thing. He couldn't hear his coach saying, "No, no, no." And we went to the line, scored two free throws, and the game was over.
One more memorial thing. When Paul Ranslow was inaugurated president in the mid-1990s. Memorial had not yet been torn down almost. And Paul, being from California, the inaugural theme was kind of surfer, beach kind of stuff. And they brought in sand and they threw sand on the floor of Memorial Gym for a kind of dance to try to make it look like a beach.
The Memorial Gym stayed for a while because it was a good venue for concerts and convocations. It did have very good acoustics in it. The Milwaukee Orchestra loved to play there. The conductor said it was just a great, great venue. But it also, Ken Carter thought, if they're going to have parties there, I'm tearing out the wood floor and pouring concrete with a drain in the center so we can hose it down. That didn't do a thing for the acoustics. And finally, it was torn down to make that open space. Just to the south of Pickard Commons, there's green space. That's where Memorial Gymnasium was.
Memorial Gymnasium was remodeled in 1930, but there were no major campus building projects between the time it was built and the time of the remodel. During this 20-year period, the college acquired several houses, including Harwood House in 1916, Sanford House in 1917, and the Duffy House in 1918.
Duffy House was on the corner of Woodside and Seward. There's a little parking lot there now, just behind the VFW. It was a kind of handsome house. Alpha Phi, the Duffy Girls, famous group.
Another house that was acquired by Ripon College in 1920 was the Scribner House, located at 416 Woodside Avenue. It was one of several off-campus residences used by college students, some of whom actually lived with Ripon families during the school year.
Before we got dormitories, the students lived with the citizens in town. We have a letter at the Historical Society from a community citizen to his daughter, who was sad by the fact that four of the eight students who lived in his home wouldn't be coming back that year. So there was not only, in a certain sense, the willingness of the citizens to host our students, but also a certain personal, almost familial relationship with them.
Most of the most prominent living houses off campus were torn down in the 1950s. And at that time, Ripon made a very conscious decision to try to get rid of those off-campus houses and have the students all live on campus in dorms, mainly because the conditions would be a lot safer. The old buildings didn't meet fire code regulations very well, and they were too old to really fix up. And modern conveniences like, you know, plumbing and electricity and so on would be much better.
The 1930s and 1940s saw a flurry of construction at Ripon College, starting with the construction of Lane Library, named after Rollin B. Lane. Lane was a former student who left Ripon to pursue his law degree before graduating. He then returned to Ripon as a young attorney before moving to Milwaukee and then California. Lane Library cost $100,000 to build and provided shelves for 100,000 books.
Ripon never had a real library building until 1932. Before that, they used, at the very beginning, the books such as they were, and it was probably a collection of about 300 or 400 books in the early 19th century, or the 1870s, let's say. They were kept in a wooden building which stood where Lane Library is now, called Athenian Hall, and that building was used afterwards for a chemistry lab and then for storage and just a little bit of everything. It was moved all around and it was eventually torn down. Then there was a library in Ingram Hall until 1932, and in 1932 Lane Library was built. It was named for an alum, Roland Lane, who lived in California, had gotten wealthy, and it was a real boon to campus, kind of anchored campus with a really beautiful building. One of the interesting stories is that they had to transfer the books from Ingram to Lane, And so students stood like a fire brigade, one student after another, and they literally passed the books onward, and then they had people in Lane Library go put them on the shelf. So for over about a two-day period, all the books got transferred that way.
In fact, some 30,000 books were transferred to Lane Library by students and ROTC cadets. However, on January 7, 1931, only 9 days before the official move to Lane Library, tragedy struck Ripon College. A noontime fire caused major damage to Smith Hall, which was being used as a dormitory at the time. Many students were at lunch, while other students attempted to rescue their possessions and belongings and escaped without any major injuries. However, the driver of the fire engine died of a heart attack while on the way to the fire. Smith Hall was razed and rebuilding began. But the event further enhanced the need for additional dormitories to be built.
Surge of building dorms on campus started really with tri-dorms, and that was right before the Second World War. But after that, from I'd say about 1955 to 1960, you had the quads go up, you had Johnson go up, and Scott, I believe, was a little earlier than that, but Scott and Johnson got additions almost as soon as they were put up. So you had this, the campus really looked a lot different in 1960 than it looked in 1940.
One such building that changed the look of Ripon College was Frank J. Harwood Memorial Union, which was dedicated in 1944. Great Hall, the main room within Harwood, was completely refurbished about 60 years later, and the room continues to play host to headline speakers who come to campus. The grassy area behind Harwood also is the popular venue for Ripon College commencement each May, weather permitting, of course.
In the 40s also, you had Harwood Union built. That took the kitchen out of West Hall, and the dining hall was now down in Harwood. And Harwood Union had all the campus activity offices and all the deans of students' offices, and wasn't used for much else. There's two other kinds of housing that should be mentioned. One of them was the barracks that were put up after the Second World War, because Ripon, like all schools after the Second World War, had lots of people coming on the GI Bill. And the men were put up in what were called barracks, which were just like old Quonset huts. Some of them were where Kemper Computer Center is now, and that had once been Kemper Clinic. And others were north of Middle Hall, where there's just a bunch of trees now. And then Faculty Apartments was built sometime in the 1950s, I believe. And it was a kind of interesting effort financially. A bunch of trustees went together and formed a private corporation, and they built the building and those buildings, and then didn't get much of a profit out of it. It was their way of giving the buildings to the college, but they were really put up privately rather than by the college. And faculty members who were here, especially faculty members who were single, who had maybe been here only for a short time, could live there. Staff members, a lot of them, lived there. And I do believe it was also open to married students. We never had a married student housing situation, as a lot of campuses did. And there weren't very many married students ever at Ripon, but the few that were there would be able to live in faculty apartments.
One of the advantages that Ripon College offered to a new hire was to move into faculty apartments, because they were relatively inexpensive and available. We had a two-bedroom for $80 a month, which was pretty cheap, even with our $5,000 salary. And George Miller, Bill Tyree lived there, secretaries lived there. Ione Haney, the secretary to the Dean of Men and Women, lived there for many years. Carla Gottlieb, a famous art historian. We've had some pretty exotic art historians over the years. She may be the most, but Irwin was pretty exotic too. And it was a nice place. One of its advantages were that George Miller got all his stuff from Brooks Brothers. And out in back of the faculty apartments, they were on the corner of Lincoln and Oak, two sides, there was the incinerator and the trash. And he used to put his Brooks Brothers boxes out back there. So my wife and I would go out there and get the boxes and put our Christmas presents in them and send them to people. The washing machine was down in the basement between apartments. You didn't get your own washing machine. And every spring, there would be a huge array of socks out behind John Glazer's house where he had washed all his dark-colored socks. We knew spring had arrived.
Spring had arrived, and so too had more buildings on the growing campus of Ripon College, with more structures still to come.
There was this flurry of building in the 1950s, and then there was another flurry of building in the late 60s and early 70s, Storzer Center, which is the preceder now to Wilmore, and the Rodman Center for the Arts. They were built in the late 60s, early 70s. And then there really wasn't much major building on campus at all. Farr Hall was added to in the late 1980s, early 1990s.
The name Farr has a long-standing history at Ripon College. Farr Hall, which was built and dedicated in 1961, was largely made possible with funds bequeathed by the Farr family. Shirley Farr was a longtime trustee of the college, as was her father Albert in the 1920s. The bequest of nearly $1 million received in 1956 upon Shirley's death was the largest single gift to the college up to that time.
Since 1960s, I think the first one that went up is Farr Hall, the science building, which of course has since been remodeled and expanded. A new floor was put on top of it. Ingram Hall was sort of taken down. They took down a third of it so that there was room to build Todd Ware Hall, which was encroaching on its space. In fact, Bill Martz was having an English class in Ingram Hall when an I-beam came in through the through the wall that they were putting into place. Apparently they had mismeasured just a little bit. But Todd Ware was the next big, and that, of course, it again has been remodeled since and expanded with new classrooms on the floor and the breezeway taken out and all that. The next big one would be the Pickard Commons, which was a huge addition to campus and moved eating facilities out of the Great Hall in Harwood Union, which used to be the main dining hall and the kitchen, and took them across the street to that area. Johnson Hall was built, and that's where the sorority members moved into. After that was built. One little sad note on the Johnson Hall. We were still having concerts in Memorial Gym, and John Glazer, a history professor of distinguished character some years ago, was heading home after a concert and stepped into one of the pits where they were putting in the foundations. Did himself terrible, terrible damage. He was in the hospital for quite a long time.
Another not-so-happy memory Northrop has from his early days at Ripon College is of the Red Barn Theater, which was located on the present site of Johnson Hall. The historic building where Harrison Ford and Francis Lee McCain starred in productions while they were Ripon College students burned to the ground in 1964.
When I got here, the Red Barn was still here. And was a source of drama productions, musical production, etc. It burned down. And the drama department then moved to the Grace Lutheran Church, which used to stand next to the First Congregational Church, and was a space for dramatic productions. All the shows in which I performed were held there, in fact. King Lear, Death of a Salesman, were held there. It was a spooky place. And I think one of the ghost stories really originated there. And when they built Rodman Center, the ghost moved down there as well and has still been wandering around.
Ghosts or no ghosts, construction for the C.J. Rodman Center for the Arts began in 1971, and the beautiful new building was dedicated the following year. Then in 1990, Rodman received a new addition.
Tom Kastiker paid for the entire art wing. He gave $1 million contribution to the college and said we should have, it housed music and drama only, and there was really no particular space for art. And so we worked with the architecture, designed that area, and he paid for the whole thing. In some ways, that was a really thoughtful, meaningful, valuable gift to the college. And Gene Kane had a lot to do with that design. Lawrence had just built a huge art center, and they had a room for everything. I mean, there was a photography room and a watercolor room and an art room and a plastics room and a granite room. And it was amazing. Gene Kane said, I want three rooms, big rooms, multi-purpose, that we can use for many things as the program shifts and varies. And it has proved to be very effective. It's a great little gallery in there, a nice 3D room, and a sort of painting and sketching room, and some room for majors to work on their projects. So it's been a very effective space, I think.
In the early to mid-60s, Ripon College created a promotional film in an effort to increase enrollment. The film was narrated by another prominent Ripon College student by the name of Spencer Tracy.
Ripon goes back to 1851. It was originally called Brockway College. In 1864, it became Ripon College by order of the legislature. Soon you get to know the names of many of the campus buildings. Ingram, Bar Hall, Pickard Commons.
This is where all the students gather together at mealtimes. Suits and dresses are in order for dinner each night, and there are plenty of seconds.
It isn't long before the pride of Ripon is yours. You feel a special fondness for your school, the trees, the walkways, the buildings themselves, everything about it. A constant renewal is in progress at Ripon to try to keep up with the times. New and better athletic and recreational facilities, and the man responsible for the continued high quality of education is Dr. Frederick O. Pinkham, the president of Ripon College.
As we begin this next term, ladies and gentlemen, let me remind you once again that our educational philosophy at Ripon calls for a major emphasis upon the intellectual development of each individual student. The standard should be high, and your teaching should be imaginative and creative and challenging, just as challenging as you can make it. And your teaching should go beyond the classroom. We believe that students gain as much from you as the professors outside the classroom as they gain from you in your classes. As you know, we are concerned here with each student as a whole person. Along with the development of his intellectual capacities, we house him and feed him and take care of his social and spiritual needs. In short, we all agree that a complete, well-rounded, personalized approach to intellectual development based upon close association between faculty and student is the finest and most productive approach to liberal learning. You men and women are well-trained and carefully selected as teachers who know and understand this approach to liberal education. We are dedicated to providing the finest in educational experience for each of our students. The impact you've made upon your students may reach far beyond your expectations.
Those same professors who were listening to President Pinkham's words of encouragement were quickly being surrounded by more buildings at Ripon College as the 1960s continued to bring a boom in new construction on campus. Pickard Commons was dedicated in 1963 and named for Ripon native and longtime trustee and chairman of the Board of Trustees, Sam Pickard. The James S. Kemper Building, Kemper Clinic, which today is the campus computer center, opened in 1967 to provide health services to college students and staff. The J.M. Storzer Physical Education Center, named for legendary football coach John Storzer, was dedicated in 1968. That was the same year crews broke ground on the construction of Todd Weir Hall, which was first opened for use in 1969.
Todd Weir Hall, which was built to replace Ingram, these were all made possible by Todd Weir, was a Wisconsin industrialist who gave money for buildings in many campuses around Wisconsin. There are lots of Weir Halls or Weir Annexes or Weir something or others on campuses around Ripon.
In 1973, just 4 years after Todd Weir Hall was built, the college again benefited from the Weir family. Ripon received additional funds totaling over $1 million. And the Todd Weir Learning Resources Center was added to the Backup Lane Library in 1974. Todd Weir Hall also underwent an extensive renovation some 30 years later, which was part of another building flurry at Ripon College.
When David Joyce was president, starting in 2003, there was another sort of flurry of building on campus, and the most Pickard Commons was extensively remodeled. That's when Todd Weir was extensively added to, and probably most significantly, that's when the senior dorms were added. The first new dorm built in a long, long time at Ripon, and meeting a need to have dorms of a very modern kind where students live in them, kind of like apartments. I think they're called senior apartments, in fact. And so that was a big building boon.
The other major addition, come to think of it, is the apartment complex that was built, from my perspective, fairly recently, what, 10 years or so? Maybe longer, that give us student housing in an apartment-style relationship. That's been nice.
The senior campus apartments were built and dedicated in 2007. Another significant move that happened during the tenure of President Joyce was a move Dr. Joyce made himself, literally, back in 2006.
There is one other building we haven't mentioned, the Carnegie Library, Pearl's House of Fashion. Now, President and Dean's office.
And the Carnegie Building has a whole bunch of history that goes with it, not just in Ripon, but on a national scale as well. In the fall of 2015, Ripon Historical Society docent Gene Woolley explained some of the building's history to a group of Ripon second graders who were on a historical tour of the city.
He gave money for libraries and built 1,679 libraries all over America. And that's one of them. It's called the Carnegie Building because Andrew Carnegie gave the money to build it.
So I'm in the Carnegie Building. This was the library of the town of Ripon until 1973. And then it went through various iterations after that, and it was Pearl's House of Fashion when the college purchased it in 2006 and refurbished it. And it's a really beautiful building. The woodwork in this building is spectacular. Turn of the century, and what I love about this building is it gives off the kind of impression that you want for a student or a parent or an alumni or even a member of the faculty or staff who come to visit the president of the college or the dean of faculty. It's a serious building, and it's august, and it's beautiful, and it connotes history and the sort of legacy of the town and the college. But it's not so stiff and stuffy and formal that it feels like you're not talking to a place that you know, values personalized relationships and learning.
2008 brought another very significant change to Ripon College. But it wasn't to any one specific building, but rather to the very heart of the Ripon campus.
The campus had always been split by Elm Street and Seward Street coming together in a corner. And for a long, long time, people had thought, you know, if you could close that those streets off, the campus would flow together better. It would be safer. There were, over the years, some minor incidents of people getting hit by cars as students were rushing across the street and so on. And in 2008, the college got the city to close off those streets. And so they put up a plaza and green space to really bring the campus together. And that has been, I think, an important enhancement to the college.
Dr. Joyce, we're now at the corner of Seward and Woodside, which is kind of where the new project begins, if
Absolutely.
You just want to take us through what's happening here.
Sure. Well, as you can see, the road has already come out, so it's no longer Seward from this point forward. It's, we don't know what it is yet, but we'll call it the walkway. And over in this general area, we plan to create the entrance to the college. There'll be stone signs that say Ripon College 1851, and again, to create this sort of the boundary of where the campus really begins and the walkway begins. As you can tell, that this is a road used to be 40-some feet is now 22 feet. This, in essence, is really a fire lane because we have to make sure all the buildings are accessible to fire equipment. And we wanted it to look narrower, so you have the concrete in the center and then you have the brick pavers on the edge to give it the illusion that it's actually narrower than 22 feet. There used to be a high hill over here. That was shaved down and fill was brought in so that it smooths out the contours, also easier to mow. And this will be planted with grass and landscaping and trees and the like. We wanted this as open as we could, more grass, more green space. And we did, as you can see, that pad over there. Mm-hmm. We did put three parking spaces for handicapped or other individuals for events that we have in the Great Hall. So we still want to make it usable and as well as safe and usable and attractive. So we're going to kind of camouflage that pad, but it does help make this accessible because we have so many events going on in Great Hall.
Okay, and is it fair to assume that the cars obviously will be allowed up there for those special events, but is that the only time? I mean, there's not going to be constant traffic through here.
No, there won't be constant because there's nowhere to go once you get in. But we did, when we worked with the city, one of the things we had to agree to was keep the cemetery accessible from this side, as well as there's the Memorial Day parade and the Veterans Parade, and et cetera, that we wanted to be able to use this area. So the road doesn't go anywhere other than to the cemetery, or the pathway doesn't. We want to discourage vehicles from using it. We also still, you know, it's the campus is an old campus. We still have to collect the garbage once a day, so we'll have a garbage truck coming here once a day. There was no way to do it up on Congress Street. So they're still, and then our own vehicles, our own physical plant vehicles, and all on occasion will have to come. But we want to discourage it. We don't want to encourage vehicles to come on through. There's nowhere to go.
We're now right out in front of the Commons area on the corner of what used to be Elm Street and Congress, kind of to the end of our tour. What do you think?
It kind of is the perfect place to end. This is the turnaround and the drop-off for the Commons. Also, we'll have some handicapped places over here for folks to be able to park, as you can see right there, so they can have access, and access to the library. And I look up here, and I look kind of what used to be a road and on a hill, and you look down to the tri-dorms, and you get a really great sense when you think about these overhead lines out, and you think grass and trees, how beautiful this is actually going to be. I think Bob Young, when he was talking to us earlier, was absolutely right. Everybody will be jealous for the way this campus looks and has come together.
Fantastic. David, thank you very much
for taking my pleasure. Time out today
to tell us what's going on.
It's an exciting time for Ripon.
Changing the traffic flow clearly changed the look and feel of the entire campus. Andrew Prowitz was in his first year as Ripon College archivist.
As archivist, I acquire, preserve, and make available documents of enduring value from the college, and I make those available to the public, to the college, anyone who's interested in them. So studying the history of the college is really important because it allows students and community members to understand the identity of this place. But Ripon College is a really vibrant story that's been around since 1851, slightly before. It's a fascinating story. It's different from many other colleges. So many different personalities and important stories have come from our existence.
Zach Massetti became Ripon College's 13th president in 2012. Since his arrival, there have been numerous changes to various parts of the campus, as well as some very important changes connecting the college and Ripon's downtown.
So we moved our bookstore downtown. So Beauvais Mercantile is now a downtown place. And we did this in part because we wanted to help spur economic development downtown. So we wanted to put something down here that would drive our students and alumni and others to come downtown. And we worked in coordination with Jay's Barbecue to sort of own that corner. So our bookstore is there. Students can come at night and have coffee and study, which they do. We have concerts down there occasionally as well. Also in downtown, one of the small things we did through a program that this office has, where we give away $21,000 grants through the year to make improvements, small improvements to infrastructure, is we put murals downtown. There are two murals. Rafael Salas did a beautiful mural on the side of a wall. That's the old longhouse from the Ceresco settlement. And then our students did a series of smaller paintings that are alongside the wall right now where Revive Hair Studio is as well. Then on campus, where the old bookstore was, is now our career development center, souped up for our students to do interviews with prospective employers. It's all teched up so people can do it via Skype or via video conferencing, and a chance to interact and put the career center at the center of the college experience. So now when prospective students take a tour of campus, they stop in front of the career center, and it's shown and showing their parents this is a central part of the college experience at Ripon. It used to be sort of tucked away in a place that was much harder to find. Other small things that we've done, Little Hall East Theater, which was a historic room that I think where the original National Forensics League debate meetings were held. The room really hadn't been upgraded probably in, my guess is, at least 50 years, maybe more, and it needed a major upgrade. It's a beautiful space now with modular furniture all teched up as well, and a classroom where we really hold a lot of our premier smaller events on campus. The Center for Politics and the People done a lot of events there. Todd Ware 104, which is where our faculty meet for their faculty meetings, also was a room that was redone. New furniture, we ripped out some things that were in the wall that weren't being used anymore, and now is a really probably our nicest big classroom on campus as well. So there's a new fire pit in the center of campus right across from the brand new Spot, right? So we rechristened the pub the Spot, and if you go in there, it's also been redone. And on the walls are the old signs that used to be in the old Spot downtown, and there's stuff on the menu that you could have ordered at the Spot then. And even the Commons has been redone. Right at the beginning of the time I was here, the upper part was refurbished with help from Sodexo.
But without question, the biggest project under Massetti's leadership is the construction of the state-of-the-art Wilmore Center. The college's greatest gem opened its doors in 2017.
The big thing, obviously, we did was the Wilmore Center. And this was a $25 million, ended up costing the college about $23 million. Then the Bolt Company put in a couple extra million dollars because it ran over budget, but wasn't our responsibility, but they, to their credit, helped us out. It's really a beautiful building. The history of this is the old Storzer Center had been built in 1967. It was a building that at its time was cutting edge, but by the time I got here, it really felt like, you know, you were gonna go work out with Lyndon Johnson and Richard Nixon. It didn't feel like a building that was 21st century, and it was dark, and it was set up in many respects for a different age of athletic competition and a different age of the way Americans exercise. So for instance, there were racquetball courts in the old Storzer building. Now for someone who's 18 years old, that's just not a sport that 18-year-olds play anymore. But it sure was 50 years ago. Today it's not. The building itself didn't have adequate space for locker rooms for the community. It didn't have good sight lines. The bleachers weren't ADA accessible. There were just a whole host of things, and the building itself was needed help. So we set about trying to figure out how to redo the building, and not just how do we fix the building up, but how do we turn this into a 21st century cutting edge, best in the state, best in the region, and certainly, arguably, one of the best facilities for a school our size in the nation. How do we do this? And this was daunting because the college hadn't done really hadn't done a major building renovation like this in many years. The key element to this, in terms of the financing, comes from one of these crazy little stories that's worth mentioning for history. So I get every month from colleges all over the country, I get alumni magazines, and I usually spend an hour a month where I'll bring the whole stack, and there's a big stack on my desk right now, and I'll just sit on this sofa here and I'll flip through. I have the trash can right next to it, and I'll just flip through, and then if I see something I like, I rip it out and send it to somebody on campus. Hey, check this out, see what you can do. Most of the time I just flip through quickly and throw it in the can. So I'm reading an alumni magazine from Emory and Henry College, which is a small school in Virginia, liberal arts college, and I see a little squib, a little note that says, Emory and Henry College receives a $17 million long-term low-interest loan from the U.S. Department of Agriculture to build a new health and wellness center. And I think, good night. What is this, right? $17 million to build a new athletics center, small private liberal arts college, rural area. Ripped it out, sent it to our grants person, said, just check into this, see what this is about. And so she did, and we started going through the process, and turns out Wisconsin is part of this program, and in fact, Wisconsin has, in the 2 years prior to the year we applied, Wisconsin didn't even fulfill its quota of money out. They returned money to the federal government in this program. And most of the buildings that were built were not things like this. They were healthcare centers, hospitals, elder care, these kinds of things. And so we went to the Wisconsin office and said, look, here's what we'd like to do. And we worked very closely with them, and even our members of Congress and Senate helped us out. And so we got this $15+ million loan, 2.75% interest, paid back over 40 years, right? No bank in the world would ever have given the college those kinds of terms. So then what we set to do was we were going to go out and fundraise against that. Knowing now we've got $15 million from the federal government, now let's go out and see how much more we can raise in cash to help pay off that loan, right? Because what you don't want to do is just borrow a bunch of money and not have raised against it so that you can help pay it back. So we went out, really spent 3 or 4 years trying to raise the money to sort of help defray that. In the end, we raised over $8 million, which is pretty good. You always want to raise more, but it's pretty good. And there were people like Dina Wilmore, who the new center is named for, who made just significant contributions to that amount.
And whereas the legacy of the physical education professor and coach, John M. Storzer, will continue to be recognized in the new facility and will live on in the health and well-being of Ripon College students, faculty, staff, and Ripon community members who pass through its doors. Now, therefore, be it resolved. Yes, we're here. That the college, Ripon College Board of Trustees, honors and recognizes Dina G. Wilmore for a lifetime of service to Ripon College and dedicates its new campus athletic wellness and health center by naming it the Wilmore Center after Dina G. Wilmore, class of 67. Go! Dina, we're presenting to you this lifetime membership in the Wellness Club, but I apologize that it will not fit in the credit card reader if you buy any pop. Congratulations, Dina.
And one of the things that's really unique about the Wilmore Center is we put serious money into the marketing of the building inside the building. And you see this. I mean, the building has soul, right? It's not only is it architecturally beautiful, but you see the faces of our athletes in there. You see the history of Ripon College athletics in there. Men, women, so these, you know, large names in the Ripon history, Elaine Call, John Storzer, Bob Gillespie, all these names are part of that. Doc Weiske, they're all part of the building's history. Plaques up to people who made a difference in making the building happen. Many of these people are either trustees or people like the Like family who were so helpful to us. It's a time capsule in a certain level of the town of Ripon and this college circa 2017, right? And that people will be able to look at this building in 30 years and say, wow, these are the people that made this building possible, and this is how it happened, and look at the nice history. And that's the hope when you build a building like this, is it really shouldn't be, doesn't need to be touched for 50 years, the way the old Storzer Center was. This is a building that is built in such a way that nobody should have to spend or think about what to do with it for quite a long time.
A building of this size and scope does not happen easily, especially when the community that is being called upon to support it is relatively modest in size. The extraordinary effort made by the staff, we've all talked about it, but it's true, combined with the deep generosity of the donors, leaves me in awe and proud of what we all have accomplished. So let this building forever symbolize what this college and this community can accomplish when we work together as a team. A beautiful, bright beacon shining on Wisconsin's prairie, welcoming all to a healthy and happy life. Thank you.
Ironically, all three of those original campus structures, East, Middle, and West Hall, could fit easily inside the Wilmore Center. So one thing's for sure, a lot has changed since those first three buildings were put up in the middle of the 19th century. We hope you enjoyed this campus tour of the structures of Ripon College. Thanks for watching.